Thank you, Mahima and Steve, for joining us. And the session is now live on Facebook. I'll hand it over to Mahima to take it forward.
Thank you, Arjun. Hello and welcome everyone for this session with University of York. I'm Mahima Kapoor. I'm the India representative for the University of York. And I have with me today Mr. Stephen Levett. He's the senior lecturer in professional practice at York Law School. So in this discussion today, we will be talking about the University of York and in specific, our very popular York Law School. So I'll start with a quick introduction about the university. And after that, I'll hand it over to Steve, who will be sharing information about York Law School and the different courses and opportunities available for students at our university for the law department, with the law department. So to start with, I'm going to share my screen here. Just give me a moment. I hope you're all able to see the screen. So we'll start with the University of York, where we are located and what is it that we are very popular for? What makes University of York popular? So University of York, as the name suggests, located in the city of York, which is about 2 hours away from London by train. It's about an hour from Manchester and about 20 minutes from Leeds. That's where we are located. So York, it's in Yorkshire County. If any of you follow cricket, I'm sure you must have heard of popular Yorkshire Cricket Stadium. That's where we are located. York is a very beautiful, it's often been rated as one of the best cities to live in UK. It's one of the safest city. It's been rated as one of the safest cities, got the lowest crime rate in as compared to any other part of UK. So it's very beautiful, very green and very safe. We are part of the prestigious Russell Group. So there are 24 universities which are part of Russell Group. We are one of them. In fact, as per the National Student Satisfaction Survey, we are among the top 5 Russell Group University for the quality of teaching. We have been awarded Gold Award by UK government for the Teaching Excellence Framework. So University of York holds an excellent academic reputation in UK. We are also among the top 25 universities targeted by the leading employers. We have an excellent support system available for students. So there is accommodation services available to students. So we have one of the biggest campuses in UK and also one of the beautiful, it's 500 acre campus, and we do offer on-campus accommodation for students. And there is also career support services available for students where we help students to get into their dream jobs. So it's like I mentioned before, it's one of the very beautiful campuses that we have, and there are a lot of extracurricular activities as well which are there on campus. So other than academics also, we have a very vibrant student life, and you know, where international students can experience that. So we have students, we have about students, like there are about approximately 18,000 students. Out of that, about 4,000 students are from 150 different countries. So it's, you know, the experience that student will have will be very, the international experience for which students actually go to UK is something that they will definitely experience while they are at University of York. We have about 150 South Asian students right now. So we do have societies where we celebrate all Holi, Diwali and all different festivals. But at the same time, it also gives an opportunity for Indian students to actually mingle with other nationalities and get that experience, that international experience for which they have decided to go and study abroad. There are more than 250 societies and clubs they can be part of. We have a sports village. We have our Olympic sized swimming pool on campus. There's a gym on campus. There are a lot of extracurricular activities on campus. In fact, we have our own radio station on campus. So any of your students have ever thought of being a presenter? So probably York is the place where they can get this opportunity to be a presenter. We have our own, like a student run, a cinema hall on campus. So there are a lot of extracurricular activities on campus, which they can definitely be part of. So starting with, you know, what I mentioned, like we have a 500 acre campus, which is divided in campus west and campus east. So today in this discussion, we will be talking about specific for like York Law School. So I will give you a, like, you know, I'll show you a short video. It's a 2 minutes video, which will give you a campus tour. That's where campus east is, where our York Law School is located. So this will give you an idea what the campus looks like. Also what the accommodation look like. Because a lot of students will ask you this question, if there is accommodation available, if yes, what it looks like. So here is just a quick short video to give you an idea what our campus looks and feel like. Here you go.
Hello,
Thank you. So this was just a quick video to give you an idea of what the campus looks like. Campus East specifically, because that's where we are located. I mean, York Law School is located. We have two campuses, Campus West and Campus East. Now I will request Steve to share information about York Law School, why it is so popular, what is so interesting about York Law School, and why should students come to York Law School. Over to you, Steve.
Thank you, Mahima. I'm just going to share my screen as well. So Mahima, could you, you've stopped sharing yours, haven't you? So hopefully you can all now see my screen. My name is Steve Levett. As Mahima said, I am the Director of Professional Practice at York Law School. And I'm also one of the co-leaders of the University of York Law School's Legal Clinic. So I might mention that as we go through a few things today. I'm going to take us through quite a few slides, but I'm going to say some brief things about most of the slides because I want to just give you a flavour of what it's like to be at York rather than taking you into the detail. And much of the detail you'll be able to see when you upload this slide presentation after today's session, and also through our website, which has all the information that you need. Those are my contact details, just in case anybody wants to ever get in touch with me, stephen.levett@york.ac.uk. I'd be really happy to either contact people by email, or we're also used to working on Zoom now. If you wanted to contact me and set up a Zoom call or a Zoom chat, I'd be very happy to meet you and to chat with you. Let me just deal with one thing very quickly. I thought it would be useful just to give you a very quick coronavirus update, because obviously this is an issue which has affected us all, and it's a continuing issue for all of us. The University of York and the law school in particular is slightly unusual compared to most of the other universities in the UK, in that we have continued to provide face-to-face learning and tuition for our students. So our York Law School students, for example, in the first and second years get around about one day a week in class, sitting face to face, working in coronavirus safe classrooms with their colleagues and with their students, with their teachers. And we know that students have really appreciated that. Our third years also, they get opportunities to come in when they're doing their case studies and for dissertation conversations as well. And the plan going forward is that we'll continue to deliver a blended mix of teaching, both in the classroom and some teaching online. We have moved some of our teaching online, and it's turned out to be incredibly successful. I'm quite surprised at it. Personally, as a teacher, I found it surprisingly enjoyable. I actually thought I wouldn't enjoy teaching online. But because we work in very small groups, we get to know people quite well through the online provision that we do. And I find that some of our students have a positive preference for online learning. They actually like the fact that they can use various tools within the online calls that we do in order to communicate and to discuss and chat and talk about the topics that we're delivering. So it's been a really big effort by the university, but I think we're very proud of what we've achieved so far. Looking forward, obviously things are becoming much more optimistic than they were this time or even 6 months ago. A vaccine has been approved in the United Kingdom. You might have seen this. The first doses of the vaccine are being delivered today, and they will begin rolling out the vaccine from early next week. So we look forward to a situation where the bulk of the population will have been vaccinated by April. And that means that many of the measures which are in place to control COVID can be removed, and people can go about their ordinary life in the way that they used to. We currently offer mass testing for students, so our students who are returning home at the moment can do so safely, and they'll also be offered mass testing when they return in January, so they'll be able to return safely as well. And overall, the city of York is in a much lower tier than the other cities in and around York. So the government has introduced different tiers of protection, different levels of protection, if you like. York is in the second lowest tier, which means that most of life goes on. Yesterday I went out for a lunchtime meeting with my son in a cafe. We sat outside, it was raining, but we were undercover, and it was lovely to see him again. So we're able to meet, shops are open, businesses are open, people can travel and so on. So overall, things are moving forward with coronavirus, and we look forward to that continuing. So York itself, as a university, is a relatively young university, and the law school itself is even younger. We were founded in 1963, part of a new wave of universities, but we very quickly secured a very high reputation, very strong reputation, and we are a member of the Russell Group of UK universities. And if you don't know the Russell Group universities, then they're kind of an Ivy League of universities. They include universities like Oxford and Cambridge and Imperial and Durham and so on. And we're a part of that group. So we're a very research intensive university, but we're also a university which takes pride in serving its local and regional economy. We have a range of extremely good accolades. We came 16th in the Guardian Times Higher Education University League tables in 2021. We have the Gold TEF Teaching Excellence Framework Award, which is the highest level you can get. And that's for consistent delivery of outstanding teaching, outstanding learning, and outstanding outcomes for its students. And it's worth just looking at some of the additional accolades that we have. And I wanted in particular to pick out the green one saying 94%, because that's the percentage of our undergraduates who are in employment or further study 6 months after graduating. 94% of our undergraduates are in employment or further study 6 months after graduating. And if you unpick that statistic in a department like the law school, for example, what you'll find is it's not just that people are in jobs, it means that they are in jobs that they want to be in. So our law school students, for example, are highly sought after by the top 10 or 20 law schools, top 10 or 20 law firms in the country. So law firms like Clifford Chance, for example, Norton Rose Fulbright, Allen and Overy, our students go and work for those law firms where it's extremely competitive to secure jobs. So we have extremely good performance both in national league tables and international league tables. And if you look at the league tables, you'll find that the law school sits slightly higher than the university itself normally. So for example, if the university is around about 136th, something like that, in the world league tables, goes up and down from year to year, the law school will be at 125th. It tends to just slightly outperform the university itself. We've been fifth in the UK for law, fifth in the UK for research in law since the last research evaluation framework exercise. So our legal research is highly regarded and is amongst the best in the country. And that's because our academics are so well known and so expert in their fields. Mahima's already told you a little about York, so I will skip over this part of the talk, but we are a brilliantly centred location. York is about an hour and a half, 2 hours by train from London, and we're about an hour and a half to 2 hours train from Edinburgh, the capital of Scotland. We are just 30 minutes train journey from Leeds, which is where you can go watch the cricket if you want. We're less than 50 minutes away from Manchester, so if you wanted to go and watch Manchester United or Manchester City play football, you could get there and back in a day very easily. And our nearest airport is only a 45-minute drive away at Leeds as well. Leeds Bradford is the closest airport, although Manchester often receives many students coming from India, and that's also a 50-minute train ride. So we're extremely well located. And we're a beautiful, beautiful city. I cannot ever do a talk about the university without talking about York itself. You might recognize this if you're a Harry Potter film. This is the street in York called the Shambles, which was the basis for Diagon Alley in the films that you might have seen. It's a very old 14th century street. It used to be a street of butchers. It's now a street of Harry Potter shops. So if you want to go and buy Harry Potter memorabilia, you can buy as much as you want. We're a cultural city. York was built on waves of immigration from the Romans 2000 years ago to the Vikings around about 1200 years ago to the Normans and on into the Tudors and so on. Our Minster, which is our beautiful church, is almost 1000 years old. And that's what you see standing behind the Vikings here, who come every year to reenact some of the famous battles that took place in and around York. And it's just one of the many festivals that we have each year. We have a book festival, we have a literature festival, we have a comedy festival, arts festival. There are absolutely loads of them. And the countryside in this area is unbelievable. It's just beautiful. This is part of the Yorkshire Dales. This is about, I'll probably take about 30 minutes to drive to this area. But at the same time, you could be on the beach in 30 minutes by car. Places like Whitby, where Bram Stoker wrote Dracula, that is less than a 45-minute drive away and one of the most quaint and picturesque places you could wish to be. So it's an absolutely glorious place. in which to live and work. So let me tell you a little bit about the law school itself. The law school was established in 2008, so it's a relatively new law school. And that's important. It's important because it meant that we could start to design our law program from scratch. So we could have a really good think about what it was we wanted our law program to be about, and importantly, about how we delivered the law program. I'll say a little bit more about that in a second. In an LLB, each year, the LLB will be around about 220. It's a little bit higher this year because of some of the changes around COVID and some of the academic qualifications issues that arose in the summer as a result of COVID. So we're slightly bigger on the LLB this year and slightly smaller on the master's program. But typically, you'll be looking at sort of 250, 300 students maximum on the LLB undergraduate programs and around about 80 to 100 on the master's program. And what that means is we're a very informal department. We're very friendly. You can come and knock on our doors at any time. We have office hours, but most tutors see students in and around the building outside of teaching time very often, very regularly. And our curriculum is, as I say, designed around a novel approach, which is called problem-based learning. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about problem-based learning, but it's fundamentally about learning by doing. And it's about learning about problems which are connected and complicated rather than artificially separated and simplified. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a second. We have an amazing building. You can see at the moment, the building on the left of the screen is the law school, which is shared currently with the management school. But actually from July, I think, of next year, the management school is going to be moving out. So the entire building will become a law building. So we have absolutely wonderful facilities and these are open and available to students 24/7. So you can access these at any time in the day or night if you wanted to. It's not how you might imagine a traditional law school, though. If your picture of a law school is this, a great big lecture hall with hundreds of students crammed in, eagerly taking notes from a tutor who stands at the top of the platform and talks for an hour or 2 hours without interruption. If that's your idea of university law schools, then you need to think again as far as York is concerned. This is not how we do things. Here is the typical environment for learning at York Law School. So this is one of our problem-based learning rooms. And what you can see first of all is you can see it's a small room. There are about 10, maybe 12 students in the room. That's a typical size class for our problem-based learning classes. The person at the front of the room writing on the electronic whiteboard is not the tutor. That's one of the students. And we call that student the scribe because what they are doing is they're writing on the board, capturing everything that's being discussed in the classroom by their colleagues and peers. So they're responsible for recording what's going on in the classroom, as well as contributing to what's going on in the classroom. So what about the person in the blue shirt? That must surely be the teacher. Well, no, that's also not the teacher. That is another student. This time the student is called the chair, and that person is responsible for leading the conversation and discussion around the problem that the students are discussing on that particular day. And the roles of chair and scribe roll around the classroom as the weeks go by. So everybody gets the opportunity to gain experience of leading the conversation and taking responsibility for recording the meeting, the discussion. So it feels very much like a boardroom meeting or a kind of brainstorming session. It's everybody sitting around a big boardroom table talking about a topic that they've previously looked into before they came into the classroom. Oh, I should just say, you can't see the teacher there because the teacher in the classroom is, of course, right to the back of the classroom, to the right of the screen. And they're sitting there and in the role as a teacher, we spend a lot of time facilitating what's going on in the room. So I would typically, in a session like this, I would typically speak perhaps 5% or 10% of the time. And my role would be to kind of gently nudge people towards the correct answer to make sure that they understand what the point of the curriculum is that we are looking at that day and making sure that they go away with a full understanding of what's going on. I don't sit there and just talk to them for an hour or 2 hours. It's them discussing the issues, which is what's really important. So problem-based learning is the approach which we apply to our entire undergraduate law degree. And it also affects the way we deliver our master's programs as well, because it's a pedagogy. It's a philosophy of learning and teaching, which our tutors buy into. And as a result, they use it wherever they go, whether they're teaching master's programs or undergraduate programs, they use problem-based learning automatically as an approach. And what the problem-based learning methodology does is it places a problem at the center of the learning. So normally, if you go to a university to study law in the UK, you will have 8 or 9 topics, subjects, which you will study in separate modules. So you might have a family law module, you might have a criminal law module, you might have a contract law module. And each of those subject areas will be taught and studied separately and independently. But that's just not the way that the world works. When I work in the student law clinic, what I find is clients come into me, into the clinic, and when they present themselves, they often arrive with a bundle of papers in a plastic bag, which they put on the table, and then they sit down and I ask them to tell me a bit about their problem. And after they've stopped crying because they're so upset, they then somehow manage to tell me a story which involves, you know, all sorts of bits and pieces of different areas of the law. Because as a client, they don't understand that the law can be compartmentalized, can be put into separate areas. For them, all law is the same. It's all bundled up. So you might get a story that tells you a little bit about land law, a little bit about family law, a little bit about civil law, a little bit about criminal law, and it's all wrapped up and confused in the problem. And the student's job, the job of the lawyer, is to try and unpick that information in order to understand exactly what is going on with this problem. And that's a realistic approach to the law. It's very skills focused, and it's very much focused on trying to understand what the problem is, how to identify the constituent parts of the problem, and then what to do in order to understand and deliver a solution to the client. So we train our students in what we call the 7 stages of problem-based learning. I won't take you through this, but it's a systematic approach to working with legal problems. And these skills that are acquired through studying the 7 stages of the PBL process become skills that students apply automatically in their professional lives. And we find that not only do students use them in legal environments when they leave the university, but they also can apply them to business problems, to creative problems, to all sorts of working environments outside of the law in order to provide solutions for people who are looking for them. So it's a very systematic approach that students are trained in and they come to use as second nature. You will find other law schools in the UK which use problem-based learning from time to time. The difference in York Law School is that we use it all of the time. The entire program is built around problem-based learning. And it's a very different approach. And what you can see here is when you look at the structure of our 3-year undergraduate program, you don't see us identifying core legal modules. So although we teach all of the core legal concepts, so things like property and obligations and criminal and public and so on, what we do is we bundle them up together and we teach them in what we call foundations in law. And you can see over the first 2 years, you learn foundations in law, you do foundations in law on a circular basis. You repeat the subjects over and over again. So you keep coming back to them at an increasingly difficult level. And that's, again, a unique feature of the law school. We don't do in year one criminal work and then never come back to it in year two. What we do in the foundations in law one is introduce you to criminal law in the context of a problem, and then in foundations in law two later on in the year we come back to criminal law and we expand and deepen our knowledge and understanding of the areas of criminal law through a new problem which is a slightly more complex problem, and so on. Keep coming back to it in a circular fashion. We also place a great deal of emphasis on skills and ethics. As you can see, in both year one and in year two, you will be required to take a module in legal skills. And this covers things like preparing for a negotiation and tackling a negotiation with an opposing side of lawyers. It covers things like making applications to the court. It covers things like legal writing and legal drafting. So all the kinds of skills that lawyers need when they actually get out into practice, you use in order to deepen your understanding of law and the legal system. So it's a very blended approach to teaching. We also do a two-year senior status LLB. So we often receive applications from students who don't have a law degree, but have a non-law degree. So for example, a science degree, and want to become lawyers, and they want to study law, but they want to do it a little bit more quickly. And because they are already accomplished students, because they've studied previously at university, we place them onto an accelerated law degree where they cover the same topics as you do on a three-year LLB, but you do it in a slightly faster way and with slightly reduced options to ensure that you're able to do it within the 2 years. So that's available for non-law graduates. Our assessments are extremely wide-ranging. We are not a one-size-fits-all institution in that we make everybody sit exams at the end of the year and all of the exams are just essays. We examine in all sorts of ways. So as soon as I finish this talk, for example, I'm going to be examining my law clinic students all day today. And the way we're doing it is we're doing it by a group viva. So the students who have been working together over the last 4 months in firms of four or five students will come together and they will be asked a series of questions to discuss amongst themselves whilst my colleague and I observe what they're discussing and mark them in accordance with a set of criteria that apply to that. So we use very, very different methods. We use courseworks, we use vivas, and we use essays and problems in order to assess students. We also use portfolios as well. So let me just say a very quick word about current tuition fees. So these are the fees for 2019-20 for master's programs. And they give you just an idea of roughly where we are as far as fees are concerned. You spend around about £18,000 per year for a master's program. It's roughly similar for an undergraduate program. And you need then on top to spend around about £9,000 to £14,000 for living costs. It's a lot cheaper to live in the north and in York than it is to live in London. Accommodation costs, for example, in London are roughly double what they are in a place like York if you live outside of the campus. So those are some idea of the current tuition fees for master's programmes. Let me tell you a little bit about the master's programmes, because we do have quite a wide variety of master's programmes, and I think it's worth just spending a little bit of time talking about these. Again, the teaching in the master's programmes reflects some of the teaching that we do on the undergraduate programme. So some of it is based around problem-based law learning, problem-based learning. I think it's really important to understand that the people who do the research in our departments will also be your tutors as well. So, for example, we have an LLM in law, which is a general master's programme. And this enables a master's student to put together a program based around their particular interests. So we give you a solid knowledge base in legal theory and practice, and then we give you the opportunity to pick a whole range of optional modules, which would enable you to construct a master's program that's really about those areas that you're particularly interested in. So there's some of the sample types of options that you can have a look at. Excuse me. A very popular master's program at York is the International Corporate and Commercial Law. It's our largest program. This year we had around about 50 students. We typically have around about 50 or 60 students per year come onto this program. It's designed to give you a critical understanding of the process of globalization worldwide, and to look in particular at issues of corporate governance. So by corporate governance, we mean how laws are constructed to regulate the way that business is done, and in particular, how laws are constructed to govern how companies operate, and many of those companies being multinational companies, so there are complexities around how you actually control those companies. It's a three-term structure, and some of the optional modules include principles of financial regulation and financial crime. So we have quite a lot of strength in the department on the issue of the law and finance and how the markets are regulated. So it's an extremely popular option, the International Corporate and Commercial Law Programme. Our second most popular programme is the LLM in International Human Rights Law and Practice. It's a fascinating program. It brings together both lawyers and non-lawyers to look at the practice of international human rights law and to acquire skills in which will enable you to be more effective as a human rights practitioner. We have a number of fellows who join us each year from non-governmental organizations, often working in very dangerous environments. So, for example, last year I met a fascinating lawyer who had joined us from Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, and who whose work was to support the families of children who were being murdered on the streets of Rio de Janeiro by the police force. And it was a fascinating, she was fascinating to talk to about the issues, and she brought something unique to the program, which really enhanced the experience of the students on the course. So those who are interested in human rights and wish to undertake guided fieldwork are able to undertake this program. The fieldwork that is part of the program normally takes place in Kuala Lumpur in Singapore, but also takes place in the UK as well. So there are opportunities to work with organizations to practice some of the skills associated with being a human rights activist. We have an LLM in legal and political theory. This is taught in conjunction with the Department of Philosophy and the Department of Politics. And this is indicative of a growing move within the department to increase the range of interdisciplinarity of our law degrees. So we recognize that increasingly the lawyers of the future will not just be lawyers, they will also be business people, they will be designers, they will be coders, you know, they will have a whole range of skills and knowledge. So for example, on the undergraduate degree, one of the modules that you can choose in your third year is a module that's taught in conjunction with the Department of Computer Science and sees you designing an app for use in a legal environment alongside computer science students. So it's a real partnership. This particular master's program is taught in conjunction with the Department of Philosophy and Politics, and it explores core issues of political and legal theories. And again, there's some of the modules that you can have a look at if you're interested in. A new development which was launched this year is the new LM Law Juris Doctor program. The LM Law Juris Doctor is aimed at those who are thinking about qualifying in either the United Kingdom or in particular other jurisdictions such as the United States or Hong Kong, Canada and various other jurisdictions. I won't take you through the details of how you qualify in the UK. It's quite a long process. And it is changing at the moment. But for those who are interested in being a solicitor or barrister, the LLM Law JD offers an alternative route, which enables you potentially to qualify both as a UK lawyer and a lawyer in other jurisdictions, such as the United States. It's a 3-year program. And at the end of it, you acquire a qualification, which is recognized across the world as an entry level qualification into legal practice. For example, if you want to go and study in the United States, you have to have done 3 years of law study before you're able to do the New York bar exam. So this program will equip you with the knowledge and amount of time study that you need to spend in order to then sit the to apply to sit the New York bar exam and qualify as a US attorney. Alternatively, you could take this qualification and use it in order to apply to sit the solicitor's qualifying exam, which would enable you to qualify as a lawyer in the United Kingdom. So it's practically focused. It draws on the undergraduate law degree in the first 2 years. So you study the same things that you would study on the LLB senior status 2-year program. And then in the final year, you do a range of modules which are designed to show you what it is like to work in a real commercial law practice. So the modules are focused around specific skills that you will encounter if you're working as a commercial lawyer in a legal practice. Finally, a word about how you get into the York Law School. The current offer for undergraduate programs is 3A, so it's a high grade requirement. We do attract a very strong cohort of applicants. We look for an IELTS of 6.5 minimum and 7 for master's programs. And for the master's programs, we would normally expect you to have a 2-1 or equivalent law degree before you came or other degree before you came on to our master's programs. So we are a demanding law school. We don't make any excuses for that. but we offer you a program which enables you to maximize your skills and also to demonstrate a range of skills and knowledge that you acquire over the course of your studies. So it's demanding, but we support you throughout. I think probably Mahima will expand on scholarships, but there are a range of scholarships that are available at the university. They range from academic excellence scholarships to individual scholarships for postgraduate studies, such as the Vice Chancellor's scholarships. And there are a range of different opportunities that you can explore if you're interested in securing a scholarship. Again, Mahima's already mentioned the very wide range of support and guidance that's available to people when they come to York to study. We really care about our students. Students are organised around colleges. So when you join the University of York, you'll be joining a college. And those colleges are kind of small units, if you like, where students spend time together. So there's, for example, as an example, there's inter-college sport. So you'll join Constantine College, for example, and you will find yourself in competitions with other colleges from around the university, and it becomes quite intense and you become very attached to your college. It gives you a sense of belonging apart from belonging to the University of York. So lots of support for you both during your stay here and also when you first arrive in the United Kingdom. And that support extends into helping you to find a job. The York Law School is extremely lucky in that we have a dedicated careers advisor, careers counsellor, Chris Wilkinson. Chris Wilkinson is a former corporate lawyer, and he has tremendous experience of working not only with law firms of all kinds, ranging from big multinational corporate law firms to small high street law firms, but he also works very closely with a range of employers right across the spectrum, anybody from, you know, Rolls Royce to Marks and Spencer to the civil service, and he is able to support you in securing a place to work or a placement if that's what you were interested in during your time at York. I'll leave these slides on the University of York International Pathway College for you to have a look at individually later on when you look at the presentation afterwards. Suffice it to say that the University of York's IPC College provides a range of language and study courses of different lengths, which act as both courses for students who are intending to come and study undergraduate programs and want to get an idea for the way that we learn and teach, because it is different, and also want to improve their English language skills. And it does the same for master's programs. So there are master's, pre-master's programs that you can study. And in some cases, attendance on the International Pathway College courses means that you automatically secure a place at the university's law school or management school or whatever school it is that you're interested in going to. So there's a lot more information on the International Pathway College contained in this presentation, but you can also have a look at the website on top of that. So I'm conscious that we wanted to leave plenty of time for questions, and we've got about 15 minutes left. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to stop sharing now,